Thanks for joining us on the midweek edition of the news on DBS TV. You're welcome. Monday, January 11, 2021 night, breaking the 12th, was a particular one in Kongsamba at the place called Carrefour Balondo. A road accident occurred at this spot, causing one death, one severe injury and material damage. A truck carrying goods like wood and many others was coming from the west region to Douala when it met the unfortunate fate. Eyewitnesses of the accident and those who saw the immediate effects recount the scenes and how they struggled to rescue those and what could be rescued, like this road user says.
The car was already on turning. Then the tires were still turning. Yeah, the driver, we saw only the driver. He was still communicating. Then that's when we started putting all this item out of the road.
They say the fatal accident occurred at a pothole located on this bridge. They add that the wounded driver was quickly rushed to a nearby hospital where he is currently receiving treatment. Following the road accident, dozens of vehicles piled up on the road with travelers and passers-by stranded. Many of them, alongside elements of law and order, put hands together to clear the road and let circulation continue to flow again. Traffic was finally restored after many hours and vehicles resumed their journey. Still in Kongsamba, the mad rush for water by these children simply shows that the precious liquid is scarce. According to images captured by our reporter, the water distribution channel has been punctured as well as electric cables. To avoid the worst and improve on the supply of water and electricity, a survey from the Unit of Production, Transport and Distribution in the Mungo Division has been initiated by the Divisional Delegation of Water and Energy Resources. It will, in practice, identify damaged water pipes and electric cables seen on the ground for repairs. With a global budget of about 54 billion francs CFA in the Adamawa region, the public investment budget for 2021 will largely be concentrated on two main projects: the construction of a hydroelectricity dam at Warak to supplement electricity in the three northern regions, and the rehabilitation of the railway line between Ngaoundiri and Belabo, a project that will be realized to the tune of about 36 billion francs CFA. While launching the budget for the region, Tuesday, January 12, 2021, the regional governor, Kyudadi Tegeke Buka, called on stakeholders for an optimal respect of public contract code and revenue mechanism, stressing that chances would not be given for errors.
Priority of this finance law is to continue with the implementation of the fight against coronavirus and its consequences. And in second, we can talk about security, because without security, economy can't grow. And we have the implementation of the decentralization policy through the grow the resource allowed to the collectivities.
Being launched at the time when the COVID-19 pandemic is continuing to threaten economic activities in the region and beyond, the priority for the current fiscal year was well spelled out.
Mismanagement will not be tolerated, and the necessary skills have been given to every stakeholder, and I do hope that they will implement it carefully and diligently.
The main focus of the 2021 finance law, as experts have, is to encourage the consumption of products made in Cameroon. Out of Cameroon, the Economic Community of West African States Assessment Mission on the Transition in Mali has ended on January 12. The ECOWAS team met the main actors in the transition, the political class and other players in the electoral process. During a press conference, the institution's delegation welcomed the installation of the organs of the transition, but in particular called for more inclusiveness so that the 18-month transition leads to a transparent general election. As of now, the transition has 14 months left to effectively organize activities of the official elections, President of the ECOWAS Commission and member of the delegation, Jean-Claude Kassibrou, said. To achieve this, the mission of the sub-regional institution invited everyone to engage in more dialogue. The mission also warned that any process to destabilize the transition government must follow the legal provisions in force in Mali and the international convention. The mission would report back on its stay and make recommendations to ECOWAS head of state at a summit scheduled before the end of the month. It is very common for an opposition leader in every democracy to leave his camp and join the presidential majority. This is the case of the Union for Political Change UPC party of Zeferin Diabre in Burkina Faso. The announcement was made on Tuesday during a press conference at the UPC headquarters in Ouagadougou by its president, called since January 10 to join the government as Minister of Reconciliation. Appointed Minister of State in charge of national reconciliation issues, Zeferin Diabre, the one who had until then been known as the number one of the Burkina Bay political opposition, officially joined the ruling class. According to his statement, there is no longer any reason why he should remain in the opposition, as he was called upon by Rogmark Christian Kabore to help him set up his presidential program. "I thank President Kabore for the consideration he has given our party. I would like to solemnly assure him of my entire loyalty and my firm commitment to successfully address the issues of national reconciliation," Zeferin said. UPC activists have not failed to express all their support to their leader, wishing him well for the new year and in his new journey in the ruling camp. Uganda has ended a presidential campaign and is set to go to the polls on Thursday, January 14 for presidential and parliamentary elections marred by political repression as Bobi Wine challenges President Yoweri Museveni's 34-year rule. On December 26, the government banned campaign rallies in the capital Kampala and 15 other counties, citing the risk of spreading COVID-19. The country has blocked access to social media and messaging apps ahead of the 10th polls. It comes a day after Facebook closed fake accounts it said were linked to the government, saying they were being used to boost the popularity of post. President Yoweri Museveni is seeking his sixth election term in office after 35 years in power. Bobi Wine is campaigning for president as candidate of the National Unity Platform Party, which has become the main opposition group in Uganda. Opposition and human rights activists have accused the government of paving the way for another election victory by President Yoweri Museveni. According to several Sudanese media, fresh violence between Sudan and Ethiopia's border have eloped, killing 6 civilians and 2 people reported missing. The two neighbors are blaming each other and tension continues to be high in the El Fashaga Triangle region, a fertile area claimed by both countries. Several sources from Sudan have accused the shifter. They are Ethiopian military men, auxiliary to the army, who allegedly attacked the village of Leya while the inhabitants were harvesting maize. Sudan's army reportedly intervened to repel the attacks and clashed with Ethiopian forces. The Sudanese army reportedly recovered the bodies of killed civilians before burying them in the presence of military officials and residents. This very fertile area had been partly occupied by Ethiopians for decades, but since the war in Tigray began, the military resources of Addis Ababa had been redeployed to the north, and the Sudanese army took the opportunity to take back part of this land, the demarcation of which has never been clear. In Mali, President Lazarus Chakwera has declared 3 days of national mourning after two members of his cabinet died due to COVID-19 on Tuesday in the capital, Lilongwe. They are local government minister Linson Belekeng Yama and the Minister of Transport, Muhammad Sidik Mia. Speaking on state media from his residence in the capital, Chakwera ordered that national flags fly at half-staff and called for 3 days of national mourning. Their deaths come as Malawi deals with an unprecedented rise in cases and deaths from COVID-19. The government is equally considering declaring a state of emergency. Malawi has recorded 9,027 cases and 203 fatalities. The Southern African nation has confirmed 15,000 cases in the last 14 days alone. On Sunday, Chakwera said he was entering a 21-day prayer and fasting session against COVID-19. The pastor-cum-politician has been criticized for not taking the pandemic seriously. Out of Africa, U.S. Vice President Mike Pence, in a letter to House Speaker Nancy Pelosi, said he did not support invoking the 25th Amendment to remove President Donald Trump just a week before the end of his term, saying such a move was not in the country's best interest or consistent with the Constitution in a decision likely to lead to Trump's impeachment. Pence said the mechanism should not be used as a means of punishment or usurpation and reserved for cases of medical or mental incapacitation. Pelosi has called on Pence to secure the majority of the cabinet and vote to declare Trump unfit to serve. This means Congress is not guaranteed to begin impeachment proceedings tomorrow as planned. The impeachment attempt follows the chaos at the Capitol last week when the president's supporters stormed their way into the building. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi has said if Pence rejects the use of the 25th Amendment, the House would move to impeach him. Several Republicans have said they will vote to impeach Donald Trump. Four Republican representatives, including Liz Cheney, have said they will vote to impeach President Trump. The President of the United States summoned this mob, assembled the mob, and lit the flame of this attack, Cheney said. Under the 25th Amendment, Vice President Mike Pence and a majority of Trump's cabinet would need to declare Trump was unable to perform his duties. Just weeks before taking office, President-elect Joe Biden's incoming U.S. administration has received unwelcome news from the European Union in the form of a wide-ranging investment treaty agreed between the EU and China. The landmark agreement with Beijing could complicate transatlantic cooperation on China after Biden's team signaled disapproval of the deal. The agreement, concluded this week after 7 days of talks, is a significant coup for Germany, which saw its six-month term as EU president expire on Thursday, and which sees China as a major market for its auto and other industries. EU officials say the agreement, known as the EU-China Comprehensive Agreement on Investment, will allow European companies to compete more equally with state-owned companies in China, which is now the bloc's second-largest trading partner after the United States. It may be an even bigger win for Beijing, which is facing harsh global criticism over its human rights record and is seeking a new foreign investment as many companies move operations out of the country in response to the US-China trade war and other concerns. The deal includes provisions for settling disputes, requires greater disclosure of Chinese state subsidies, and restricts China's practice of demanding that foreign investors share their technology in exchange for market access. The deal was met with dismay by US President Donald Trump's team, whose administration has engaged in a long-running trade war with Beijing. And while Biden advisors have been less vocal about their approach to China, they had signaled reservations about the pact and a desire for more input before it was concluded. In a similar story, the United States has imposed a further import tax on some European manufacturing parts and alcoholic beverages in a tariff dispute between the two parts. The new tariffs, which became effective on Tuesday, comes after talks failed to resolve the 16-year dispute over EU's aircraft subsidies. The European nations involved are France and Germany. In a notice to shippers late on Monday, US Customs and Borders Protection said the new duties would apply as part of the long-running battle over government subsidies to Europe's Airbus SE and its US rival Boeing Co. Both Washington and Brussels believe the other is providing an unfair advantage, so with the approval of the World Trade Organization, tariffs have been repeatedly introduced from both sides. This latest move involves a 25% levy on all aircraft manufacturing parts, as well as on wines and other grape brandies with alcohol content higher than 14% from France and Germany. Alcoholic beverages below 15% have been subject to a similar tariff since November 2019. Brussels said it would seek a swift resolution of the issue with the US President-elect Joe Biden, who takes office on January 20. The Biden team had no immediate comment on the tariff issue, but Biden's nominee for Secretary of State, Tony Blinken, has previously called for patching up transatlantic relations and ending Trump's artificial trade war with Europe. That marks the end of today's edition of the news on DBS Television. Thank you for watching. Do well to stay with us until we come your way again tomorrow. Goodbye.